Hi, this is David with EdgeStar Technical Support. Here with me, we have the DWP61ES Portable Countertop Dishwasher. This is a technician level component replacement video. Customers can view this as well. However, we strongly recommend that you get a professional to do this for you. This does cover both the 60 and the 61 series of dishwashers. Here we have the DWP61ES Portable Dishwasher. The procedures that we're going to be showing will cover both the DWP60 and the DWP61 since they're identical. The first thing that we're going to do to remove the shell is we're going to remove the screws on the back of the unit, which all you need to do this with is just a simple Phillips screwdriver. The first thing we're going to do is we're going to turn this unit around. And as you can see, there are some visible screws. You get two here at the bottom, and then here, here, these two, and then the two on the opposite side. There's also some screws underneath. I'll show you those in just a moment. Now what we're going to do is we're going to go ahead and we're going to flip the unit over. Now what we see is one Phillips screw here, same on the other side. And you'll see a series of tabs. There's four of them. There's two here and two on the other side. There's also two hidden tabs underneath this front separation here. And we'll need to get those out in order to release the shell. Okay, now that we've removed all the screws on the back of the unit, you've removed all your visible screws here, flip the unit over, remove your two screws at the bottom of the unit, and got your tabs loose. Now we're going to turn the unit around. We're going to remove the front screws on the shell. Then we're going to be able to remove the shell entirely. So I'm going to spin this around. And as you can see, we're going to open up the door. Now you've got two screws on each side, and then you have these two here. So we're going to remove those. And then once I get those removed, I'll show you how to remove the shell. It basically lifts off, but you have to be careful with it, and you have to sort of tilt it around. I'll show you that here in a moment. Okay, now that we've removed all of our screws on the front and the back and at the bottom, we're ready to lift this cover off. There are a couple of things that you do need to know about. The cover, when you get ready to remove it, you need to make sure it's bowed out on both sides. That way your clips are loose, and this whole cover gets lifted off as one piece. It's very important that you're very careful with this cover. It is extremely flimsy. If you tweak it during the removal or installation, it will never look right ever again. So you need to be very careful about how you lift it off. Once we lift it off, there are some spacers underneath that hold the shape of the cover and support the cover, and I'll show you how to remove those here in just a moment. So for now, I'm ready to lift off the cover on the unit. I'm going to do that right now. We're going to pick it up by the edges in the center on the sides. Let's work your hands underneath, lift it straight up and away. Now as you can see here on both sides, there are two spacers. They're small and they just sit on here. They're little plastic pieces. As you can see, they look just like that. You have one here as well. We're going to set those aside. Now I'm going to turn the unit around. And you'll see that there's this spacer here on the back. It's all one piece, just lifts off. Now we're ready to access the inside of the unit. The first step to remove the washing cabinet for access to the underside components starts on the inside of the cabinet. As you can see, there's several pieces here that need to be removed. The first one will be our spray arm, and then our filter assembly, and then our sump filter, and then underneath all of that, there's a couple of other pieces. The first thing that I'm going to do is I'm going to remove the wash arm. It just simply clips to the top of this stud. Lift it straight out and set it aside. Next thing that we're going to remove here is we're going to remove the filter ring. You twist it counterclockwise, pull it out. The next thing will be our sump filter. This lifts out as one piece, as you can see. The next piece will be our stud where our wash arm sat. There's two Phillips screws that hold it in place. Once you remove those, up and out. The last thing to remove here is our sump ring. Now the first time that you do this, it's going to be very difficult to remove that sump ring. What I would do is take a small flathead screwdriver and use these bosses and gently tap all the way around until it comes loose. Once you do that, you're going to spin it counterclockwise until it stops, pull it straight out, Now we're ready to do a couple of other things here on the outside of the cabinet. So I'm going to spin this dishwasher around. I'm going to close the door. I'm going to spin this dishwasher around. And as you can see here on the one side, there's a ground strap. That ground strap has a screw and a nut. There's also a lock washer on it. You need to remove that. So what I've done here is I've already removed the nut. So we're just going to back the screw out and remove the screw. It doesn't matter what order these go in, they're all just grounds anyway. Right here underneath this pulley, as you can see, there's a pulley here with a spring. There's a single Phillips screw. You're going to remove that. It's identical on the other side, same thing. The last thing that we're going to do here to free up this cabinet is we're going to go back inside the wash cabinet here. This is a vent tube on the outside here on the back. What we're going to do, there's a retaining nut here, as you can see. We're going to remove that by just turning it off. It's threaded. Set it aside. And then you can pop the vent loose from the cabinet. Just like that. I'll move the table a little bit. But there's your vent. There's another similar vent that's on the other side. It has the same setup, but the nut's a little bit bigger. Once you get that nut loose from the inside of the cabinet, just pop the vent loose on the other side. Now what we can do is we're ready to lift up the cabinet. In order for us to do that, we're going to close the door up. And we're going to spin it around. And here's that vent that I was talking about. As you can see, it's just connected to these hoses. What we're going to do to access all of your components, once you get that other screw out here below this pulley on the other side, then you can lift up the whole thing and get to your wash and pump motors. The only thing is, there's hoses underneath that attach to this at various points, and they have clamps. Those clamps are a lot like the ones that you see here. They're single-use clamps. You have to cut them off to get them off. Once you do that, you're going to have to replace them with a similar clamp. But you'll have to cut these off. As you can see underneath here on the sump, there's a fitting over here, and then you have these over here. You also have a fitting here as well to remove later if you need to. You may not need to remove those. And that's how we access the underside of the unit. As you can see now, I've removed the wash chamber for better access to our pump and our other components which sit underneath of it. And as you can see, I've put it in a position where it's out of the way. To do that, you'll find that there's a small clear hose attached to the side of the wash chamber with a copper clamp. You're going to bend the copper clamp out of the way, and then you can tuck the hose back into the base here, as you can see. What I want to do really quick is cover each component in a logical flow so that when you're doing troubleshooting, it makes things a lot easier. First thing we're going to talk about is water levels. We have to have some way of controlling the water level inside the wash chamber. To do that, we have a mechanical float with a switch, and we have a float meter that transmits that information into the main computer so it's able to cycle the inlet valve and keep that water at a constant level. Over here we have the air gap for the intake. We had to remove that when we pulled the wash cabinet off. That mixes water and air into the system just like an aerator on a faucet. It's no different. Behind that here, as you can see, there's two black wires going over. This is our flow meter. When the computer commands the inlet valve to open, water flows through the line. The flow meter senses the flow and tells the computer that the valve is open. Moving backwards here a little bit, this is our main wash motor. This does all of our wash duties in the unit. Behind the motor, we have the relay that transmits power to our motor and our associated wiring. And now we're going to move back, and we have our inlet valve. This is a solenoid valve. It is controlled by the computer. It opens and closes as it needs to, and the customer actually hooks their hoses to the outside of this on the back side of the washing machine. Moving backwards here a little bit, now we're getting into the drain end of things. On this side, we have to pump the water out, the dirty water, up through this air gap. We have to have water and air mixed so it's able to push it out. Our drain pump does that duty. It only works during the drain cycle. Back on the main side of the main sump assembly here, we actually have a booster heater. And this heats our cold water. As you can see, I've got one here so you can see what it looks like because it's all encased in here. Attached to this, we also have a thermostat, of course. We have to regulate the temperature in here, so that will cycle on and off as it needs to. Back here in the corner, we have our main computer board. You cannot access this board from this side of the assembly. You have to do it from underneath. That's a really quick overview of how this works, and that should simplify your troubleshooting.